Hi, it's Kiffin Bates here, and today I want to talk a bit about an article in Wired that Benjamin Sangma pointed me at, which proudly proclaimed that blockchain technology will one day make it impossible for people to sell stolen Rolexes. And the reason why I want to talk about the article is because it is a really good example of how the actual problems that exist in supply chain and actually in identity are subtle and complicated, and that these kind of articles gloss over them and actually give a false expectation of what is possible in the space at the moment and what is feasible in the future. So the article gives an example of an expensive luxury watch being taken to an expert who then provides a verification of its authenticity, and then the watch owner is given a metal plate with a QR code on it, and they can scan that and see the details of the watch and pictures of the mechanism and stuff like that, so that when they sell on the watch, they also hand over the metal plate and the buyer is assured that they're buying the genuine item. But anybody who thinks about this for more than a couple of minutes will realize that if you're dealing with counterfeiters who are producing knockoffs of $10,000 watches, then making a simple metal plate with a QR code on it and cobbling together a fake website that QR code points to in order to make it seem like the knockoff is actually genuine is not going to be particularly hard. I mean, they've already proven that they can make duplicates of these expensive watches. So what's so difficult about putting up a website and making a QR code? Not much. So the issue here really is one of identity. How can a physical object be verified to be genuine in an automated way? And that's where you come into things such as, for example, in the semiconductor industry, there are PUFs, or physically unclonable functions, where you look at the structure of a chip and it always has some defects in it due to the random process of manufacturing, and those act as a fingerprint. So that means that a chip manufacturer can record all these different defects for different chips on, for example, a blockchain, and people can later verify that the chip that they got is the genuine one and not a knockoff, because it's got to be on the list of known inventory rather than some grey list of faked chips. And you know, this carries over onto other physical things, such as, for example, diamonds. They have particular structural flaws that can be scanned for optically, so you can register those on a blockchain. And the issue then with a watch is that yes, it will have particular physical characteristics. Maybe they could be used to log each watch on a blockchain, and those characteristics, that record or transaction, can then be signed by the manufacturer, so you know that it is a particular luxury brand that did produce that watch, because they've used their digital signature to verify the properties of each and every watch that's on the market. Another possibility, because watches are devices, is that you could put, for example, an RFID tag or maybe even a small battery-powered IoT device inside it that can actually respond to a challenge and prove its identity time and time again. And again, you can then go to a public blockchain and check that the item is there, and maybe people can even register that they own the watch, and then when they sell it on, the new owner is registered too, although then we have all sorts of privacy concerns. So you see, when you look at the article, it's a lot more complicated than they first make out, and it kind of comes across as though they missed the point in the first place. It's a tricky but very interesting area of blockchain, and I think it's got a lot of potential, but we're still in the early days. And when you see articles where they are putting forward these very simplistic solutions, it misses the point, and it actually, I think, damages the reputation of things such as blockchain in the supply chain and identity space. So I really wish that they would be a bit more careful about their journalism. Anyway, I hope that was interesting, made some sense, and I'll see you in the next video soon. Bye for now.